is Georgi Gozev. I'm a journalist at Euractiv.com, the EU policy website. And I made my studies in Romania. I'm familiar with the situation in Romania. That's why I think I was invited. I had the honor to be invited to moderate this debate. And I wish to say something personal, as I'm the country I know best is Bulgaria. I wish that sooner or later there will be a similar debate on Bulgaria as well. Now, why are we here and why are we together? Mr. Verhofstadt will come. I saw him yesterday night at the summit. I'm sure he is here. And by the way, I noticed that there was a similarity of positions expressed by Mr. Verhofstadt yesterday over the summit with the positions of the Socialist and Democrat group. And there is a similarity of positions in Romania as well. In Romania, we have a very difficult political situation. We have basically ruling populists and a very broad alliance. It's called the USL, and it's a coalition between the Social Democratic Party of Victor Ponta, who is with us, of the center, of the National Liberal Party led by Crin Antonescu, Mr. Antonescu, and the Conservative Liberal Party of Daniel Constantin. Therefore, we have a very broad coalition, which according to polls has the support of 60% of the Romanians. On the other side, we have a party which is shrinking and according to polls has a support of something like 18%. Having said this, in the Romanian parliament, there is, because of an artificial situation, basically the ruling party has majority. And that's why Romanian went in the streets in spite of the cold weather, and the protests continue for a third week. Later in the debate, we will have among us one of the leaders of the protests. And we will be able also to watch a short documentary film on the protests in Romania. But now, without further ado, I would like to give the floor to the representatives of the two parties, who the two political groups in the European Parliament who initiated this debate. And my first speaker is Catalin Ivan, member of Parliament from the Socialist and Democrat group. Mr. Ivan, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. În primul rând, vreau să vă mulțumesc pentru.
Thank you very much. First of all, let me thank you all for showing up in such big numbers here. And it's very important to say something from the very beginning. What is happening right now in this room is a normal thing. It is not an exception. The European Parliament represents the citizens. And whenever the smallest concern with regard to the rights of the European citizens occurs, we have the obligation to discuss it. Nowhere in this world, in no civilized country, never in the European Union, has dialogue been a bad thing. On the contrary, it is the lack of dialogue that is a bad thing. It is not debate that causes concern and a stir and an emotional stir within the political class, but the lack of debate. That is why I believe that being here and raising certain issues and expressing certain concerns that we are discussing with rational arguments for and against, I think this is something normal. It's part of democracy and it's something that we should all rejoice in. Let me warmly welcome the three leaders of the Romanian opposition, political opposition, as well as the representatives of the civil society, and I'm looking forward to our debate. Thank you.
Doamna Norica Nicolai, membru al.
Mrs. Norica Nicolai, member of the European Parliament, the Liberals and Democrats. Thank you very much. Hello, everyone. Thank you for being here this afternoon in a Romanian room, because here in the European Parliament we are at home. Romania is part of the European Parliament. And I welcome this debate. This is a debate about democracy. Democracy is government of the people, by the people, for the people. And I think it's a very healthy thing for us all, politicians, to discuss about what's happening with our peoples, because we have a responsibility to our countries, but first of all, we have a responsibility to Europe. And this responsibility was the source of tonight's debate, and I believe that this should be welcomed, because the future of Europe relies on dialogue and on understanding and communication between citizens and their representatives. And I believe that in the absence of democracy, freedom can only be an illusion. That will be our topic for discussion tonight. And I believe that the discussions that we shall have tonight will raise an alarm for all European citizens, because we can only continue together, we can only coexist democratically, and it is by debate that we can promote democracy.
The next speaker.
Thank you, Mrs. Nicolai.
Are the leaders of the political groups who are hosting this hearing, and the first is Mr. Hannes Svoboda, leader of the Socialist and Democrat Group. By the way, congratulations for your recent elections in this capacity, Mr. Svoboda.
Thank you very much, and I'm very glad to be here, and I'm very glad so many of you are here, not only on the podium, but in the room. It's one of the biggest rooms we have, so there's much interest in the issues raised by the three Romanian parties and raised by the two parties in European Parliament. And as far as I know, it's very good also that the government is represented by the Minister Surfina Babu, whom I want to welcome, because perhaps you can explain afterwards why she's coming here to Brussels to speak with the opposition and doesn't do it in Romania itself. Because when I see how many laws have been decided or bypassed by the government, by the parliament, how many important decisions have not been taken by the parliament, but by the government, by emergency measures. And if I see how, for example, the new foreign minister has been nominated by the government, also bypassing the parliament, then why not do it in Bucharest? Because that would be the normal issue. But of course, it's interesting to come to the parliament, welcome, because we always welcome dialogue, and this is the issue of the debate today. I think we're defending democracy, because democracy, you know, many of our countries, Romania has the bad area, my country, Austria, has a very bad past. Many of the countries in European Union had a very bad past. We know what it means to be democratic or non-democratic. And we know how dangerous it is to deviate from the democratic way. And of course, first, it is small steps. But finally, it may lead also to stronger steps, and that's very, very dangerous. And therefore, the fight of our colleagues for democratic procedures against the belief of some individuals they can do it by populism, by directly appealing to the people. We know that. This is what very often happened in the past and led to disaster. That one at the top said, I know what the people want, I appeal to the people, and then I decide in the consent with the people. Why do we need a parliament? Why do we two chambers? Let's do away with one of the chambers, and then you have one chamber. And why go to the chamber? I have much more interesting things to do than to go to the parliament, especially if I'm not sure I get the majority, and if my own friends perhaps start to be afraid of voting for me, so let's have the decision outside the parliament. That is a very dangerous game, in principle, wherever it takes place. And if we hear how many laws, again, have been passed, well, they are not laws for me, they are decrees, more or less government decrees, instead of having laws in the parliament is a very dangerous way. Second, of course, the recent demonstrations. Of course, it's good that there are demonstrations, it's the right of the people to demonstrate, but one has to think what is behind the demonstration. And I think the demonstration is a sign of a healthy society in Romania, that they do not accept everything the government is doing or proposing, not in the substance, but not in the way how it is dealt with. And therefore, I think that is a very important element. And we want to strengthen. We are not interfering into the affairs of Romania. We just want to say to the civil society in Romania that we want to strengthen them, that we are watching development also from the outside, but the fight has to be done inside by the political parties, by the civil society. And the last point. I know there has been some debate, and it was brought, especially by the government side, we demand sanctions to Romania. What a nonsense. We do not demand sanctions, because we believe in the citizens of Romania. They will decide who will be in the government in the next election. It's up to them, and we trust. In the contrary to the government and to the president of the country, we trust into the citizens of Romania. They will have the decision. Hopefully again, the government and the president will stick to the ruling of the Constitutional Court, because this is also a sign. If I hear, perhaps it's only rumors, that the court already decided that the two elections, the regional election and the national election, have to be separated. And then from the official side, one says, well, perhaps we stick to it, perhaps not. That would be a very bad sign if the Constitutional Court in decision, whatever the decision is not respected. So again, and with these words, I want to close. We have serious concerns about the development of some of the developments. We have serious concerns about the democratic development in Romania. But again, as a social democrat, I believe into the citizen, and the citizen in Romania will decide. If it is clear and open and transparent, then I think the citizens of Romania will take the right decision at the next election. And with that message, I want to conclude my brief introduction. Thank you very much.
Well, Mr. Swoboda just said that we know how dangerous it is to deviate from the democratic way, and the next speaker on my list, the leader of the liberal ALDE group, Guy Verhofstadt, will be able to comment on that and present his own views. But I remember Guy Verhofstadt was promoting a pro-European alliance following the European elections when you took over as leader of the ALDE group. Don't you think that now there is also a need for a pro-democracy alliance?
That's exactly what we're doing today, because I'm very pleased that as Alliance for Liberal and Democrats for Europe, we could organize this seminar together with the Socialist and Democratic group. And I think it is a very useful initiative, because I'm worried, and my group is truly worried, that there is a growth in a particular political trend in Europe, and this trend is the rise of populism and of nationalism, also the radicalization of the debate on a number of freedoms, freedom on religion. In sort, what we are seeing in parts of Europe is what I call a renationalization of Europe. And I think that deficit in respect to fundamental rights and fundamental freedoms is as such serious as breaching the Stability and the Growth Pact. We are always, every day, talking in this parliament and in the European institutions about the euro crisis and about the Stability and Growth Pact, while I think as such important is also our democratic values and our democratic principles in the European Union. And it should be a very bad thing to turn our back on this, to turn our back on the basis of why this union has been created. Yeah, we know that 2012, it is, we only started 1 month in 2012, but 2012 was already a very turbulent year for Romania. Protests has spread across the whole country. I should even say, even abroad, in front of the embassies of the country, and the message everywhere is the same. It cannot continue like this. That is, in fact, the message we hear from these protests. I think that there is a problem. It is not me saying this, but a number of international organizations, and most important, the Romanian citizens themselves. And maybe let me give you three facts. And I'm only referring to that. So it's not my assessment, it's the assessment of a number of organizations. In the 2011 Economist Democracy Index that every year is published, as you know, by The Economist, they say that since 2008, the Romanian democracy was in constant decline and is now ranks 59th place on 167 countries that are in the index. The Transparency International, that is the Corruption Perception Index, they are surveying 180 countries, and they find Romania on the 75th place, same place as China. It's a good place to be there economically, but I don't know on the corruption if it is the best place to be there. Yeah, let me give you a third element. The Reporters Without Borders, they are publishing every year a Freedom of the Media Index, and there in 2007 the rank of Romania was 52, now 42, now 47th place. So there is also a decline there. So I think it is our duty in the European Parliament, together also with a number of political parties, and also in the presence of the majority party of Romania, to talk about this, to discuss about this, because Europe is not only as I said, a single market, an economic union is very important, but also a union of values and principles. And everybody who comes in the union has to respect these values and these principles. So I'm looking very forward to fruitful debate, fruitful discussions, and also possible solutions for the future. Thank you. Thank you for your presence.
Thank you very much. We are entering now a very important part of our discussion, because we will have the three leaders from the USL coalition, the coalition which has the majority, the support of the majority of the Romanians. And I know that many of you are Romanians, but for those of you who are less familiar with the political situation in Romania, I will say that when elections will take place, and elections can take place sooner rather than later, then the Prime Minister of Romania is going to be the leader of the Social Democratic Party, Mr. Victor Ponta, and I give him the floor.
Good afternoon. I would begin by expressing my gratitude to our political families, groups in the European Parliament, for giving us the opportunity to attend this debate, to express our views and our concerns, and of course also to express my gratitude for the very important opportunity to meet some of the government representatives. It's an opportunity very difficult to have in Bucharest. It's better to be here in Brussels than nowhere. I would begin saying once again that I did not come here together with my partners of the opposition coalition to complain about something in Romania, or not even to criticize the government. This is something that I often do in Bucharest, and it's enough to do it there. I just came here with three important targets. First of all, to honestly and correctly inform you about facts that we consider a breach of the European standards of democracy, The second target of mine today is to defend the people who has been in the streets in 61 cities of Romania, because they were accused that they are there only because of economic problems, because the government cut the salaries or the wages. This is unfair to say something like that about them. They are there and they are still there, and right now in Bucharest there are 15 degrees below zero and people is still on the street because they are unhappy with the democratic level of Romania, and they look forward to have the democratic European standards that we have looked for when we joined the European Union. And I would say once again that I think that we are in the right place, because the European Parliament, it's my parliament, it's our parliament. I'm a European citizen, and I think that if there are huge problems of democratic values in Hungary, that should be debated here in the European Parliament. If there are important issues regarding Romania, they should be debated here in the European Parliament. If there are problems in Bulgaria, they should be debated here. And if these three countries who have joined the European Union looking for a better life and for the rule of the law, the people is unhappy, it should be a concern of all our European colleagues and partners, not only the Social Democrats or the Liberals, but even the ones that have the majority in the European Parliament or in the national governments. I would refrain myself only to three facts, and I will leave also my other colleagues to refer to some other issues. The three facts, which are impossible to be denied because are concrete facts, are the decision and the situation in Romania, a European country, regarding three important issues. First of all is the election, the democratic election. The second one is the way that the most important laws are adopted in Romania. And the third one is the electoral system of a democratic country. I will be very brief in these three points. The Romanian government has postponed the local election, which are supposed to be in June. It's first time in my knowledge when in a European country, a democratic country, the 4 year terms of the elected persons are postponed. And I said to the actual Prime Minister of Romania, I said, all right, we can agree with you that you can postpone the election because you are in a bad situation right now. When we are being the government, will you agree us to postpone all the election until 2030, for example? What are you going to say against me if I will do the same? Are you going to say it's non-democratic? I agree, but you did the same. Are you going to say that this is a dangerous thing for the democracy? But you did the same. The Constitutional Court just a few days ago ruled out this initiative of the government, but up to now, the coalition of who supports the government, they did not give up the idea of postponing the election, which were supposed to be on the 4 year constitutional term. This is the first issue. The second one is that in the last 1 year and a half, the government has passed 14 most important laws, and I will give you examples. The law of the education system, the labor code, because Mrs. Minister of Labor is here, the judicial law. All these laws has been adopted by assuming the responsibility of the government, not through the parliamentarian debate. We did not have the right, the constitutional right, to make amendments. We did not have not even the right to vote against this law, because the government said, this is what we want. If you don't like these laws, you can make a motion of non-confidence. We did make a motion of non-confidence. We had 20, 220 votes in favor of this motion and zero votes in favor of the government, because the MPs of the government, they did not attend the vote. So this is the way that the most important laws are adopted in Romania right now. This special procedure, which is provided in the Constitution only for special and emergency situations, was used two times by a four-year government of Social Democrats. It was used one time for a four-year government of Liberals. It has been used 14 times by a two-year actual government. And perhaps they will like to use it again. The riots in Bucharest in January began because the government announced a 15 law, the health system law, adopted once again without the debate in the parliament. The third point and the last one in my presentation would be the electoral law. 2012, it must be an electoral year in Romania if we remain a democratic country and if we organize election every 4 years like the Constitution said. I can tell you that right now, on the 21st of January, we don't know yet when is going to be the election, what is going to be the system on which we are going to run for the parliament or for the local elections. I don't really see how a government having 14% in the polls could organize the election to win it. I just want them to organize it in a democratic way. And up to date, we have no electoral law for this year's election. So to conclude, I will tell you that based on economic emergency in Romania, a European country, the democracy has been suspended. I have learned from history that many times democracy has been suspended for important things. I think it's a big danger for us as a European country, and I think we should not accept this explanation. And I came here to present these facts, to defend the people in the streets who have been unjustly accused of protesting for a salary or for a pension. And I came here also to assure our political families that us, we are determined not to use the same tools, but to get back to a democratic and European way of governing the country. I was accused by the Romanian government that I will ask for sanctions. No, why to sanction the Romanian population? Because of the fault of the government. This would be absolutely unacceptable. The only punishment for a bad government is on the election, and I hope that Romania this year will have a European democratic election. Thank you very much once again.
Democracy suspended, that's strong words, and they help us better understand the people on the streets. We don't know where the elections are going to take place, but it could go in both ways. I mean, with a constitutional role, you can have even presidential elections at a much earlier date. In any case, Romania is to hold presidential election in 2014. And according to the agreement between the coalition partners, the next president of Romania will be the next speaker on my list. It's the leader of the National Liberal Party, Mr. Crin Antonescu.
Mulțumesc. Bună ziua tuturor.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for taking part in this debate. From the very beginning, I would join my colleague, Mr. Victor Ponta, in saying that unlike what the members of the Romanian government think, we are not here to complain, we are not here to denounce, we are not here to seek help, because a large part of the Romanian political class and an even larger part of the Romanian society are mature enough today in order to defend the rule of law and the democratic quality of our country. It is the main reason why today we feel at home here together with all of you. It is the reason why we are taking part in a debate about Romania, but a debate that refers to a great extent to our bigger family, to our extended family, Europe. Therefore, it's a family affair, it's a family discussion, it's a discussion about realities, about prospects, and mostly about risks. A few days ago, the president of Romania, Mr. Trambasescu, gave a much-awaited speech, a much-listened speech, and he said, I quote him approximately, "Am I a dictator?" he said. "I am not a dictator, because I am being attacked by so many people day in, day out, in political debates, on TV, etc." That is true. There are many who criticize him. 10, 15, 20, 50 politicians maybe, 5, 10, 15 journalists who criticize him and attack him. But I do not accept that we should have this approach. I do not accept that in an EU member country at the beginning of 2012, someone bring about such arguments in order to defend and to deny being a dictator. Well, first of all, nobody said that there is a dictatorship in Romania. Nobody said that the president of Romania is a dictator. Of course, we can ask ourselves, well, 50, 20 or 50 politicians can criticize you on TV, but how many public servants, Romanian public servants, can afford to openly express their political beliefs? How many Romanian citizens can openly state their political options and their political convictions without being afraid of unnatural repercussions, repercussions unnatural and unacceptable in a democratic regime? But, however, this is not the topic of our discussion. We are here because we think it is unacceptable that in an EU member country in 2012, we even need to discuss whether the political regime has turned into a dictatorship. We need to discuss, we have the right as well as the obligation to discuss the quality and the performance of the democratic regime in that country. Maybe Mr. Lukashenko also has some people criticizing him in Belarus. Certainly the president of Russia is now and then criticized by political opponents. However, I don't think that gives us enough reason to say that Belarus or Russia are fully-fledged democracies. And I think we need to say very clearly that we are all in Europe because we have values that are different from theirs and criteria that are democratic criteria that are different from theirs. My colleague, Mr. Ponta, spoke very earnestly and openly about the government's attitude to parliament, to the political opposition, about the way in which in Romania essential laws have been adopted bypassing parliament in the last few years. But this is not just a matter of dialogue between government and opposition. This is a matter of public debate about public policies in general, or the lack of it, therefore. There is no dialogue with the opposition. This is a very distant memory. The dialogue with the trade unions is a lost memory, and trade unions to a certain extent have become history. the dialogue with the civil society is, let's say, very selective. President Băsescu recently said that it is necessary that the truly qualitative civil society should manifest itself. Well, we do not accept this idea for a EU member country. We do not accept that the civil society needs to be recognized in its legitimacy, in its representativity by the president. I don't think it can be divided into a good quality or bad quality civil society by the president. I think this can only be done by the other representatives of the civil society, by the members of that civil society. Not in any way, this cannot be done by the leader of the political system. Of course, the deficit of dialogue, of debate on decisions which are extremely important, eventually has consequences. And these consequences are not the most positive. Romania is a country that does not have a very strong tradition or a very strong culture of street protests, if you like. Today we are talking about people protesting in 60, 61 of the most important cities of Romania, although there are 15 degrees below zero. But in fact, only a few thousand people are protesting. We are far from the tens of thousands of protesters in Greece, Spain, France, etc. However, if today those people who are protesting, as they have been doing every 20 years or so, but so if these people are taking to the streets, well, they are not taking to the streets because of the economic austerity measures. This is something that needs to be clearly stated and needs to be fully understood. The austerity measures, the so-called economic austerity measures, I will use the term used by the current government. So those measures were taken in May 2010. They were among the toughest measures. Undoubtedly, the toughest ever taken in any European country. Pay cuts across the board in the public serving in the public sector, 25% cut across the board, cut in the public servants sector. A spectacular increase of VAT from 19% to 24%. A freezing of pensions that are already quite small, and many, many other dramatic measures. Romanians did not take to the streets then. However, they are doing it now, but not in order to ask for those cuts to be reversed, although, of course, they are suffering because of those measures. The reason why they are taking now to the streets is, in their own words, because they feel that the only certain gain Romania has had in the past 20 years, that is, the guarantee that we live in a democratic society under the rule of law, the guarantees resulting from our membership of the European Union, are in danger. Because everybody can see, this is a fact, in Romania, power has been concentrated in the hands of only one man, and the main governing party is behaving just like the state party Romanians have been very familiar with and whom they never want to see revived again. Of course, all these matters require a detailed discussion, and I'm not sure we'll be able to fully accomplish that here and now. There are, however, obvious fact, and I must say, and this is something that even the government admits, these protests are spontaneous. They have not been organized by the political opposition, and these protests are just the tip of the iceberg. The discontent, the major, profound, deep discontent that exists in Romanian society today is visible in any sociological research, in any opinion poll that is being made, and quite a lot have been quite a lot of such studies have been made ever since last year. So we must say a few very clear facts. We must discuss these things openly within our European family. These are things that everyone needs to hear. Of course, each of us has the right to choose the political system in which they want to live. Romania is not Belarus, will never be Belarus. Romania is not Russia and will never be Russia. With all due respect for those two countries, Romania is a nation, a society that has made a fundamental and definitive choice for Europe, for the cultural, political, and family values, if you like. And if we are in this family, we're not going to leave it. We are going to stay here forever. And I think that is why people are protesting on the streets of Romania today, because they want us to stay in this family. And that is why we are here today having this discussion. In conclusion, let me say just a few words about two key elements that keep popping up in the speeches of the Romanian president and in the discourse of the Romanian government. Modernization and reform. A lot has been made about the fact that throughout these last years, a reforming, supposedly reforming power, reforming government, has had the will and the power to modernize the Romanian state, and that the opposition that has long been smeared everywhere as backward, anti-reform, and I don't know what other words of abuse. The opposition, however, is trying to block, allegedly block, this effort of modernization of the Romanian state. Well, if we are to discuss concepts rather than slogans, let us ask ourselves, what does modernity mean for the European states? Because we have our various ideological approaches to the social state, minimal state, the welfare state, the austerity state. In Bucharest, we have a never heard of concept, that of the irresponsible state, the state that has no responsibility whatsoever. Although it continues to gather the tax money of the taxpayers, although it continues to make crucial decisions on behalf of its citizens without any sort of consultation, although it continues to have a quasi-Mussolinian discourse on the connection between a leader and the people who should follow the leader, and about the fact that those who disagree should feel free to leave, because, thank the Lord, we have free circulation in Europe, and of the fact that the state has no obligation to its citizen. If this is what modernity is all about, in Europe or anywhere else, then indeed we might say that Romania has gone through a process of modernization, and maybe we, the opposition, did not understand and certainly did not support this process. In reality, the Romanian state today is less modern than it was at any given time, is more corrupt than ever, it is more pork barrel based than ever, it is more inefficient and costly than ever, it is more useless to the taxpayer than ever. And if we are to talk about austerity, well, it's a good thing to talk about austerity, but we should have all the statistical data, the true statistical data, because if we do that, we will realize that austerity has been imposed exclusively to a certain type of people, that is, the people who are not among the clients of the current government. That is why, during these times of economic hardships, when indeed some austerity is necessary, when it was necessary to cut all sorts of public expenses, in Romania, the 80-90% of the population that expresses its view in the opinion polls have seen their wealth and their economic situation dramatically deteriorate, while the remaining 10% who belong to the government's clientele have become richer and richer. And then this is visible, this has been official, they have become as rich as they liked. And as a liberal, I accept differences, natural differences and social differences between people. However, I will never accept the fact that some people enrich themselves using public funds, using the money paid and pooled together by everyone else. I shall never accept the disregard of the only equality that we can truly defend, and that is the equality of chances. Let me conclude by giving a quote not from our president, but from the ambassador of a country that has been and will continue to be our friend, that is the ambassador of the United States in Bucharest. His Excellency, while commenting on those protests, said, Romania is in a good situation. Romania is in a good direction. Romania is making progress. Because these protesters, and I quote His Excellency the Ambassador, these protesters are not being shot by snipers from rooftops. And then he added, if you don't believe me, ask the citizens of Syria. End of quote. Romania has seen people shot by snipers from rooftops, over 1,000 of them, most of them very young, 21 years ago. Those people did not die so that we can be compared today, although we have been members of the European Union for a while, with Syria. Those who make such geographical, chronological, or geopolitical confusions should know better. However, we shall never confuse the purposes for which some of our fellow citizens were shot by snipers. Thank you very much.
Mulțumesc, domnul Crin Antonescu, m-ați inspirat.
Thank you, Mr. Crin Antonescu. You inspired me to think of other comparisons. You talked of Russia and Belarus, but I thought of Italy. I thought of the situation of Berlusconi's last days in power. I like this comparison because Berlusconi left. I don't know if Putin or Lukashenko will leave, but Berlusconi finally left for the good of his people and for the good of Europe. The next speaker on my list
is Mr. Daniel Constantin, leader of the Conservative Party, a member of the Social Liberal Union.
În primul rând,
thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank our group leaders for the opportunity to come here and talk about the most important breaches to democracy after 1989 in Romania. Secondly, I'd like to thank my colleagues, European MEPs from Romania and from other countries, from our sister political groups, for allowing us this discussion. I wouldn't like to talk about the main topic of this meeting. My colleagues, Mr. Antonescu and Mr. Ponta, insisted that the Social Liberal Union never asked for a suspension of European funds for Romania. We did not ask for any sanctions which would hurt the Romanian citizens. The reasons why we are here are twofold. First of all, the situation in Romania after the presidential elections in 2009, and secondly, the events of the last 2 weeks. As you know, we have lots of protesters in University Square in Bucharest and in many squares in towns in Romania. As Mr. Ponta and Antonescu said, the protests in Romania cannot be compared with protests against austerity measures in other European countries. The economic crisis is only the background to the protests. From our point of view, the protests in Romania cry out in order to express the lack of trust of the population in the people who govern them and the institutions that the government has created. The protesters are not inspired politically, and they are not controlled by political parties. The protests express the deepening gap between the population and the ruling class. After 2004, Romania has led a policy which has discredited the rule of law. All institutions, apart from the presidency, have been gradually compromised. They have been made to serve certain political parties under pretexts which might have looked correct at some point, one after the other. The institutions of the state, the parliament, the justice, the army, the police, the local administration, and now the opposition parties, trade unions, and the press, these were either blamed collectively or blackmailed, or they were infiltrated by moles, or they were discriminated by lack of funding from the state. This policy has led to the 2012 protests. And we see atypical categories of protesters: policemen, the military, unseen so far categories have protested, such as magistrates who have refused to go into court. But then manipulation continues at the European level. The corruption of this regime, which is total after 2009, is general, and current governing methods are very similar to the methods of the totalitarian communist state. The parliament and the justice system were hit the worst. There is such a climate that dialogue, which should be normal between the government and the opposition, is now completely absent. The population has been turned into a voting machine. And parliament is a voting machine as well, which votes all the projects of the government. There are emergency decisions, there are laws adopted without a debate by the government, using excessively the assumption of responsibility. we have seen diversionary practices, such as the organization, the setting up of a so-called referendum, which was actually annexed to the presidential elections in 2009 and was actually a propaganda tool for the president. There was an ambiguous question with an answer which was very predictable, which led to renewed calls from the president to revise the constitution. We need to revise the constitution, it is true, but we must do this in order to strengthen the rule of law and democracy. We need to make justice independent and put it at the service of the citizens, not in order to give power to one person and to return to the single party system. There were some spectacular laws adopted, even a so-called law of small reform and justice, in order to speed up trials. There were some results by diminishing the responsibility of courts. But the activity of courts has become 50% more charged. This is because social and economic life registers more and more abuses, and justice decides more and more for a certain category of citizens. The government decides to cancel certain judicial decisions. Even the economic crisis has subjective causes in Romania. Corruption discourages economic growth and consumption. But unfortunately, the crisis is not felt by the most powerful of Romania. The budget deficit is not caused by a generous social policy, but by waste and inefficient spending. Romania does not have highways, but as the election campaign nears, we see more and more swimming pools or skating rinks. Any public works is more expensive in Romania than in any other country in the area. And this hits Romania's social and economic standing as well. In 2009, a government decision, which proved to be non-constitutional, which hit at the public administrations, impeding the absorption of European funds. I will not talk about the political character of public institutions. I speak about this as someone who has lived and worked within these institutions in the hope that after we acceded to the European Union, that the system of promotion will be based on competence and not on belonging to a certain political parties. Excessive politicization has happened, and this is why we have an extremely low level of absorption of European funds. These are official statistics, 3.72%. Another reason for the low absorption rate is the lack of a coherent long-term vision by the authorities. If we're thinking of the economic context internally and externally, the lack of performance can be also explained by the lack of motivation of those employed in these institutions which manage the absorption of European funds. There's a low administrative capacity at central and local level due to lack of personnel and because these people are not very motivated. Another explanation from my point of view is that the banking system is not interested in co-financing European projects. This is explained by the fact that the main institution that gets loans from banks is currently the Romanian state. when we think about all these obstacles, these are due to the desire of some people appointed politically to control these funds and to allocate them at higher costs. In 2012, after 3 years of Liberal Democrat government, the crisis has reached an alarming level. The financial framework 2014-2020 represents the largest challenge to social and democratic construction in Romania. And the attempts to have a higher degree of absorption must be left to professionals and not to party people. The erroneous measures of the Boc government have been borne by the population with resignation and with optimism, but their patience has run out and they don't even see a flicker of hope. Over 80% of Romanians feel that the reforms and the austerity measures proclaimed by the government do not excuse the incompetence and the bad faith which they can clearly see. Romanians wish to pursue the European path. They feel solidary with the destiny of Europe, for better or for worse. We don't want to compound the problems of Europe with Romanian problems. But the solution is not only up to us. Some intentions of our European friends can be misconstrued. We should prevent this. Our population has already risen in revolt and has not seen very well the visit of Mr. Antonio Lopez, who showed up and visited the Romanian president, even though, according to the Constitution, the president must be outside the remit of the political parties. And one of the problems nowadays is that the president is constantly getting involved in the activities of the governing party. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Constantin. You spoke about 3.72% absorption rate for European funds. That's by far the lowest rate, and it speaks, of course, of incompetence. But let me just say that it's not only a problem related to Romania. It exists also in other countries, and I also realize that incompetence and populism often go hand in hand. We will finish with this first panel in a few minutes. A second panel will be held with representatives of civil society, and then we will have a debate. I have seen some people already telling me that they would like to take the floor. That will be later. But now we will watch a short documentary on the Romanian protests. Mr. Stolojan, yes?
We asked from the beginning to give us possibility to have the floor of minister, representative of Romanian government,
yes,
here, Mrs. Sulfina Barbu.
Certainly. If Minister Sulfina Barbu would like to take the floor now, I'm happy to give her the floor now.
Mulțumesc foarte mult pentru.
Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to express the position of the Romanian government. As a Romanian politician, let me begin by expressing my hope that we shall be able to have similar debates in Romania as well. First of all, let me very clearly say that the Romanian government has committed itself to a necessary process of modernization and reform of our society during a period of economic crisis that does not only affect Romania. We understood that we need a stable, a financially stable union, a strong union, a competitive union. And I believe that each and every member state has certain obligations and responsibilities if we want to achieve that. We must do what is required of us at the national level in order to avoid causing more problems to the European Union. I believe this is an obligation for each and every government. And the Romanian government, following the provisions of an agreement that we signed with our financial partners, and let me quote them here, the European Commission, the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, we took it upon ourselves to implement those reform measures. Unfortunately, it was necessary to use the constitutional a right that is provided in the Constitution to invoke government responsibility in order to pass certain laws, because there was no dialogue with the opposition. Let me remind you that Article 114 of the European of the Romanian Constitution provides that the government can assume responsibility in front of the plenum of the parliament on a program, a political declaration, or a bill of law. But following this procedure, the opposition also has the constitutional right to cause the fall of the government by a no-confidence motion. So each and every time the government deposes its mandate when declaring the assumption of responsibility in front of Parliament. There is also a supplemental layer, that is the Constitutional Court. The opposition has the right to challenge any bill of law that has been adopted in such a way, to challenge it, therefore, in front of the Constitutional Court, which is a mechanism for the democratic control of the government. Let me remind you that in 2009, let me remind Mr. Ponta that in 2009 we were partners in government, and Mr. Ponta was the Minister for the Relationship with the Parliament in the coalition government run by Prime Minister Bock, and I think there were at least five occasions on which the government invoked the assumption of responsibility. And Mr. Ponta supported those initiatives, and so did his Socialist Party. So this happened in 2009. A lot has been said here about reforms. Well, let me refer to one reform measure, the labor code. We think, and the government thinks, it was absolutely necessary to change the labor code, to change the old labor code that had been approved in 2002 by means of the same procedure, that is, the assumption of responsibility by the government. This code no longer coincided with the priorities of our society. We needed a more flexible law in order to create more jobs, in order to create more opportunities for young people to access the job market. In order to do that, it was necessary to change the legislation in this field. And I believe this is one of the most important reform measures that have been undertaken by the current government. Also, there was a mention made on the elections and on the idea to hold elections at the same time, the local elections and general elections at the same time. The logic followed by the government when proposing such a measure was a strictly economical one, because an election campaign entails a certain slowdown in the activity of the state institution. This is a fact in Romania, and this would have happened during a year when we absolutely need the state institutions to work like clockwork in order to better absorb the European funds. However, a democratic check, the democratic system of checks and balances has worked. The Constitutional Court has spoken. We are now waiting for the explanation of its decision. Therefore, we are at the beginning of an election year. We are going to have elections, and citizens will decide who has the right to run the country. It is absolutely true, there are demonstrations in Romania, there are protests, and people are right to protest. It's a democratic country. But solutions to those problems are political solutions, and we are reaching out to our colleagues from the opposition. Let us identify political solutions to solve people's problems. But this requires dialogue. This requires coming up with alternative solutions. And this is how it has to go on, as in any democratic society, and Romania is a democratic society. Let me conclude by expressing my hope that these debates shall be continued in Bucharest. We shall continue to discuss internal policy matters, and I hope we'll be able to identify solutions to the citizens' problems, because the Union needs powerful member states that should implement the financial discipline measures decided by the European Union and should sanction any populist measures. Romania has committed itself to doing this. Thank you very much for your attention.
Your concern.
Thank you, Minister Barbu. I'm sure there are many opinions to be expressed, and in exactly 30 minutes, we shall start the debate. Now, I would invite you to watch a short documentary that has been made by the ALDE group.
During the last 2 years, Romania has been the victim of a gradual but systematic destruction of the democratic institutions and mechanisms. Social protests have been escalating the last 3 weeks against the President Traian Băsescu and the Prime Minister Emil Boc. But what did they do? The power and prerogatives of the Romanian Parliament, conferred by the Constitution, have been curbed by the government through the excessive use of the procedure of assuming governmental responsibility. 14 laws have been adopted without a public consultation during the last 2 years. One of it was adopted by fraud.
Vot pentru amendamentul respins. 260 voturi împotrivă nu sunt, abțineri 8. Vă mulțumesc. Textul în ansamblu pe acest articol, 199 voturi pentru, 160 voturi împotrivă, nu sunt, abțineri, 7, vă mulțumesc. La 254, supun la vot textul comisiei, voturi pentru, nu sunt, voturi împotrivă, 157, abțineri, 10, vă mulțumesc. Vă supun la vot, așa cum a fost formulat el în textul Senatului, voturi pentru, 160 voturi împotrivă, sunt, nu sunt, și abțineri, 10. La poziția 255, am înțeles, vot pe textul comisiei, care propune eliminarea, de fapt, acestui articol. Voturi pentru. Nu sunt, voturi împotrivă. 168, abțineri. 161, scuze. Abțineri, una. Și vă... 10. Și proiectul de lege privind sistemul unitar de pensii publice este lege organică. Voturi pentru. 170 de voturi pentru, voturi împotrivă, două voturi împotrivă, abțineri, 3 abțineri. Vă mulțumesc.
Throughout this period, the president has assumed the position of prime minister. For example, Traian Băsescu was the one who presented the healthcare law and aggressively wanted to determine the adoption of this legislative proposal. In this regard, he passed it directly to the ministry in charge. As soon as the protests started, the president decided to withdraw it, even though he is not entitled to act as the initiator of the laws. Traian Băsescu interfered on the judicial act when he asked the judges to indicate the funding source of the salaries in the public sector. the judges decided against his will to reduce the wages. The president is forcing for the adoption of a territorial reorganization reform without holding the mandatory referendum according to the Romanian law. He acts as a president and prime minister at the same time by attending the government meetings and evaluating the minister's activity. He is also the one announcing the austerity measures. The Romanian president violates the Romanian constitution by constantly supporting his own party, while the law states clearly that he shall act as a mediator between the powers in the state as well as between the state and society. The president and the government have politicized every public institution. Most of the civil servants were dismissed after the elections, and the new ones were appointed by the government according to their political views. That is also why, during the protests, the police gave penalties to the people only because they have shouted slogans against the government. In addition, one of the police chiefs was seen at the PDL headquarters.
Now, we have a panel with experts. Actually, all the three of them are representatives of the civil society in Romania. And the first speaker on my list is Professor Cristian Pervulescu. He is the president of Pro-Romania Association, and he is the director of the Group for Applied Economics.
No.
Huh?
Mr. Pervulescu is from Pro-Democracy Association.
Yes, I'm sorry. So Mr. Pervulescu is the president of Pro-Democracy Association, and you have the floor, sir.
Mulțumesc, domnule președinte.
Mr. Ungureanu, thank you, Mr. President. Since we are at the film section, we would ask the permission to show our own film, and a much shorter one as well.
I was asked to introduce this. I don't mind that we can watch this film after the end of our debate.
Well, it's normal to watch a movie after we have already seen a movie.
I'm sorry, sir. Yeah. We have a debate closing at 18:20, and we have
so
translators.
We have translations
in two languages, and if we watch the film, then the translation.
But it's already translated. No problem.
There will be no translation for the debate, sir.
Oh well, you help me to state that we are now in a state of dictatorship. With a term that you very much
we
like.
Can watch the film after the debate. Thank you.
Thank you. What?
We can watch the film after the debate. As simple as that.
Well, what I asked you is that if you use a movie in a debate, I think we have our own right to use a very short movie. It's on the same topic. I'm not proposing cartoons.
We will watch your movie after the debate. Thank you. Mr. Pervulescu, you have the floor.
Mulțumesc, domnule moderator.
Mr. Pervulescu, thank you. It's a difficult debate on this public hearing concerning the situation of democracy in Romania. It's difficult for many reasons. First of all, because people are still protesting on the streets, because political tensions are palpable, and also because it is quite difficult to discuss the situation of your country objectively in the European Parliament. However, I shall try to do so. The three of us who are in this panel have been subjected to a lot of pressures in the past few days. We were asked, why do you go there? What are you up to? What do you have to say? Well, we are here because we believe it's worth presenting the situation of Romanian democracy to the European Union. And that we say that because we are persuaded that there is democracy in Romania, and the past few weeks have shown that. However, let us not live in a world of illusions, because Romanian democracy is a fragile one. It can be turned into something else at any moment. The risks of political extremism are as serious as possible, and it is precisely on those risks that we want to dwell. What is happening in Romania, from my point of view, is a continuation, a follow-up of the protest movements such as the Indignados in Spain or Occupy Wall Street in America or the protests in Russia. And let us not forget about the strong movements caused by the ACTA legislation in Poland in the last few days. In other words, there is a general state of discontent about governments, with governments. And this happens in more or less consolidated democracies, or in countries that are about to become democratic, or in countries that are not democratic at all. The protesters in Romania have their specific requests, and their representatives will talk about them. However, for me personally, democracy is a state of mind. I start from this definition. I start from Alexis de Tocqueville's definition and description of the American democracy. Well, if democracy is a state of mind, then the role of institutions in maintaining or degrading the state of mind is essential. Without this sustained effort, democracy can be overturned or can be destroyed at any moment. It was not austerity that has caused the protest movement in the past few weeks, or it was not only the austerity measures, but also the situation, the state of mind of Romanian democracy, the way in which it works. In an opinion poll that I made in October 2010, when asking what they think about Romanian democracy, people responded that democracy is a chance of amassing fortunes and not much else. And that is because the promise of wealth for everyone was a broken promise, and the economic crisis has derailed things even further. Of course, I don't have too much time, so let me very briefly give you an example of the way in which the abuse of public resources by the local authorities can cause conflict situations. On one hand, we can say that there are problems with the election laws. The pro-democracy association that I am running has been monitoring elections in Romania ever since 1992. The problems I'm talking about are recurrent problems that show up on each electoral cycle, or problems that were invoked by the politicians earlier. One of the recurrent problems, which is expressed by public discontent, refers to electoral fraud. In the last opinion poll that we made in 2010, this is the latest data that I have, 80% of Romanians thought that fraud is widespread during elections in our country. Years before, the number of people who believed that was of 63%. So there's quite an increase. But this does not talk about a reality that can be proven from a legal, juridical point of view. Rather, it talks about a state of mind, a state of discontent in Romania. And coming against this background, the decision to merge the local and general elections and to postpone the local elections has caused a very strong reaction from the civil society, because beyond economic reasons, as the minister had invoked, many people saw this measure as an attempt by the government to obtain a better electoral score. However, this confusion between the local level and the central level of government would have been detrimental to the local to the Romanian democracy, because if citizens mix up the local level with the central government level, it will be very difficult for them to judge and weigh public policies. Another problem with Romania has to do with political style, that is, the quality of political speech, political discourse, which is unfortunately very much based on verbal violence. And secondly, the legislative process. A lot has been said about the government's habit of bypassing parliament, and such measures are hard to accept in a democracy, no matter what. 14 times is a lot. 14 times in 4 years, and 125 emergency government ordinances. This puts a lot of pressure on democracy. Also, the laws which the government is trying to adopt by bypassing parliament are very important laws. They need civic dialogue. We need civic dialogue, and we don't have it. The Romanian Economic and Social Committee practically does not function, and no other type of dialogue, of negotiation with important stakeholders such as the employers' unions or the state or the trade unions. Such dialogue is almost inexistent. Basically, until people took to the streets this winter, there was practically no dialogue in our society. So, assuming responsibility for such important bills of law only means that you are imposing your will on the rest of the society. The situation in the education system is dire, and I can say that because I am a university professor myself. And this situation is a proof of this brinkmanship that the government has employed. The consequences are dire. At the end of 2010, the government decided that there should be certain changes. There should be a law concerning changes in the education system, although the education system had a strong rejection reaction of such a law. However, the government had its way. Then another problem, the financing of electoral campaigns. The legislation concerning financing of election campaign is very weak. The controls on the actual financial actions during the electoral campaigns is almost inexistent. This dominates to a great extent the relationship between parties and society, and society has become extremely politicized and has become an extremely client-like society. The Romanian civil service was already quite inefficient and unprofessional. However, in the past few years, public servants have become pervasive throughout the system, and they are twice less professional than those who than those public servants who have no political views, those who are apolitical. However, it is those more competent public servants that are being harassed, forced to resign because they have no political protection and they need to be get rid of, to be got rid of. Let me give you an example. The University Square is a form of protest and is a place of protest in Bucharest. It has been a place of protest for 20 years and it has no connection with political parties. But let us not talk about this. Let us talk about a small village in one of the counties of Romania. In this small village, an uprising by the Orthodox faithful has started against the hierarchy of the Romanian Orthodox Church. Why? Because the hierarchy had decided to dismiss the local priest. The police, the gendarme, have been called against these civilians, against these Orthodox Christians who were protesting in order to defend their priest. And this has been done completely illegally. There was no legal basis to take such a decision. And this speaks volumes about the way in which incredible resources, state resources, public resources can be mobilized and used for in order to please the powers that be, in this case of the Orthodox Church. A similar situation happened in the month of January. This priest I'm talking about was further persecuted and harassed in the idea that he would finally resign and leave his parish. And this is what we are talking about when we talk about democracy and democratic spirit, the revival of the democratic spirit in Romania. Simple people, peasants from a small village, reacted, not because some political party told them to, and they protested because it was a matter of pertaining to their life and a matter of their everyday activity. I think this is important. Such an example is important in order to understand that radical political change is needed in Romania. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Pervulescu. I hadn't thought of the connection between the indignados in Europe and the protests in Romania, but it helps to draw some parallels. Next on my list is Mr. Victor Alistar, Executive Director of Transparency International Romania. You made reference to some studies made by Transparency International. You have the floor.
Încep prin a mulțumi celor.
Thank you. I'd like to start by thanking the SND group and the ALDE group in the European Parliament, and also the EPP group for taking part in this debate. Transparency International exists in over 100 countries in the world. It is impartial politically, and it stands for good governance and public integrity. From this perspective, I will attempt an image of the events in Bucharest. First, the main reason was social discontent, which led to a spirit of revolt. And this might have been related to economic measures, but these measures were taken in 2010 and 2011. The difficulty arose from a lack of transparency on the part of the public authorities. The authorities did not properly explain to the citizens what was going on and to what end. They did not have an idea about the direction where they were going. The lack of explanation and the lack of social dialogue led to a lack of understanding, which naturally led to rejection of certain decisions, which are harsh for the population. Together with austerity measures, we can see that the situation as corruption stands in Romania is particularly serious. In the Corruption Perception Index, we are at the same level, or the almost last level place in Europe. We have other studies. The Global Barometer about corruption shows that in Romania, corruption is endemic, from local administration to central administration, from direct services to decisions regarding public resources. And given this situation, it is hard for the citizen to understand how the state wants us to show restraint, but does not stop the waste from wasting public money. This is not about corruption. This is bad administration, bad governance, and wasting of public resources. It is quite clear that here the lack of social dialogue, the lack of transparency, the lack of predictability is quite serious, and gives the population the feeling that the citizen no longer belongs in society, and that the state is now incapable to ensure the proper level of public policy. Yet another aspect is related to the fact that public policies are not fully explained. There are lots of emergency decisions, and they do not inspire trust from the citizens regarding their effects. There is also the suspicion that these laws are passed in order to serve certain groups. The reform in local and central administration has been continuously reformed in order to support cronies, and this has been the hottest topic in the debate about the health law, which was the kernel that led to the demonstrations in Târgu Mureș. People said, after we are asked to be restrained, after public resources are stolen, after we see that the administration is incompetent, after all of this, you want my health insurance to be privatized? I cannot say if this is right or wrong, but it's the lack of dialogue on this subject that led to the lack of confidence on the part of the citizens. One example that we have is related to the way in which public resources are used and the priorities for allocating them. These topics appear in the media almost every day. The media exposes corruption cases almost on a daily basis. And there's also comparative data. Economically, Romania needed 7 billion euros in financing, according to economic analysts. The losses due to bad management or corruption at all levels of public administration and in all fields of activity are estimated at 15.8 or 16 billion euros. How can you explain to the Romanian citizen that you need structural reform of the budget for 7 or 8 billion euros, and at the same time, out of this money invested, you build parks in cities which do not have sewage systems? These cases are constantly outlined in the Romanian press. The mayors come and say, this was not a priority, but this is what we got money for. So this is what we invested in. I don't know what the criteria were. The citizens don't know what the criteria are. And so it's very difficult to explain things. So Romania went through, and recently Romania went through a very cold spell. Also, the press has looked into the contracts allocated to the companies employed to take away the snow and to clear the roads. There was a comparison with Finland. We have 16,000 kilometers of roads in Romania, and in 2010-2011 we spent 77 million euros. In Finland, there are 78,000 kilometers of road, and the total expenditure was 98 million euros. How much does it cost to take away as much snow as Romania has, and compared to a country like Finland? Romania has 4,800 euros per kilometer, and in Finland it costs 1,250 euros per kilometer to remove snow. These are things that citizens do not really comprehend. There are interest groups that have dominated the situation, then they have started to rule things, and this is clearly exposed now because of the economic crisis. There are also water management works, energy regulation, and these are things which are well known to the public opinion in Romania. Another source of dissatisfaction is the relationship with the state, which is no longer seen as authoritative or legitimate. There is a lack of involvement and a lack of consideration for the citizens. The European Union created two instruments in order to involve citizens in the administrative decisions. There is Law 52 concerning transparency and the law concerning access to public information. Lately, these laws have been applied very badly, if ever. And in the last 2 or 3 years, there is a tendency of courts to no longer cancel administrative acts which fall outside the transparency remit, if they have already been assumed. So, It means that the administration and certain magistrates who are not as willing to apply the law, they have found a means to block transparency. As for access to information, this is not respected, even concerning information which should be communicated by default. This erodes the trust of the citizens. Normal citizens believe that the administrators split the money with their business buddies. The administrators are no longer answerable for the way they manage the public money. Foreign embassies have also noted this, and they have noted the corruption in an analysis over the total value of bribes through the Constanza customs. We saw that there is a tariff for large containers and a bribe for small containers. And this is 2.5 billion of systematic bribery. We haven't seen these files, though, and we haven't seen which sums have been recovered by the state, which leads us to the second part of our presentation, the causes for this in Romania, because the government has assumed responsibility for tackling corruption, but this is empty. There are no strong institutions to fight corruption. There are no functional institutions in order to clean up the vulnerable sectors. There's no intention to go and clean up things, because if we talk about mechanisms for prevention, these do not work. And I will show you examples of reports from the Court of Accounts, the Court of Auditors, which are not applied or followed through. There are huge sums which can be recovered. There are heads of institutions that have embezzled money repeatedly, and nothing happens. Nothing at all happens. And the more corruption grows, the more media reports on this, the more the budget decreases because of this, the more the quality of public services goes down, and the citizens' dissatisfaction go up, the fewer true cases do we see in courts. And this is because there is no will to do away with this problem. The government feels that the state belongs to them, and that they administer arbitrarily certain sums of money. After years of monitoring Romania, the only solution that we see would be a proven political engagement from political parties, because if this does not happen, this will simply be a revolving door policy between parties that succeed each other in government, and the country will go even lower.
Vă mulțumesc, domnul Alistar.
Thank you very much, Mr. Alistar. I registered the fact that it's winter, there was a lot of snow in Romania, and this helped the civil society in Romania to find out some interesting things, how much it takes to take away, to clear the roads compared to Finland. And now I give the floor to Mr. Voinea, who is the head of the group for applied economics.
Dear members, dear members of the European Parliament, dear guests, I'm an economist, so I will talk only about fiscal consolidation and the role of fiscal consolidation and the road between from fiscal consolidation to social unrest. The welfare state in Romania, which was indeed incomplete and inefficient, is replaced by a welfare state. The state The state is at war with itself. The government destroys the foundations of the state from within. It affects the social fabric. Public employees are the enemies of private employees, although the structure of the economy is mixed, of course. Pensioners are the enemies of employees in general, although they were, of course, former employees. Professors and doctors are the enemies of any reform in general. Banks, oil companies, pharmaceutical companies, and so on are the enemies of the economy. Everyone belongs to a minority group, which at some point becomes a public enemy. This attitude is not only counterproductive for the economy, but it represents a danger to the fragile backbone of the Romanian democracy. The state is at war with itself. It cripples the state's ability to pay pensions by fostering a mandatory private pension scheme. It wants to abolish any form of public health care insurance by introducing the monopoly of private health care insurers. It refuses to tax the rich people more, but it welcomes any wage cut across the board or any regressive tax increase. It fights against its future by cutting the incentives for maternity and child allowances. It fights against its past by taxing the pensions once again. And it fights against its present by a suboptimal utilization of resources. The employment rate is 58%, and new policies are aimed at cutting more jobs in a restructuring effort. In recent years, Romania emerged as a wunderkind of austerity. Indeed, in 2010, the Romanian government adopted very severe fiscal consolidation measures on a scale hardly matched anywhere elsewhere in Europe. All public wages were cut by 25%, VAT increased from 19 to 24. A large part of public employees have been fired over the 2010-2012 interval. Pensions were taxed by introducing health contributions. Maternity allowances were cut. Child allowances, unemployment benefits, and all other social security packages were cut by 15% or more. Three things were striking regarding these measures. First is the severity and the unfairness of fiscal consolidation at a time when Romania's public debt was lower than 20% of GDP. Granted, the budget deficit was higher than 7% of GDP. The IMF-approved austerity program accepted by the Romanian government is comparatively much more severe than Greece's austerity package. This grand experiment in second-generation shock therapy is the most severe in Europe. Okay, and an exercise in unfairness. This is self-defeating for the economy, as well as for the imperative of defending democracy against extremism. The measures directed towards cutting expenditures, partially necessary, are procyclical, leading to a further contraction of aggregate demand. The possibility of an expansionary fiscal contraction, which means that a country achieves economic growth only by improving the efficiency of public spending, is not feasible for Romania, because private investments are simultaneously shrinking as an effect of the economic crisis, and hence they cannot replace the diminishing public spending. Austerity deepens recession as it tries to solve a private sector crisis by cutting public spending. However, austerity remained confined to wages and social security spending alone. The expenditures for public acquisitions increased every year, even by 11% this year. Public investments also increased. While this can be seen as a normal anti-crisis program, in fact, there is no independent audit on these expenditures, no form of control, and no transparency in decision making. Under these circumstances, public investments risk of being hijacked by interest groups and various elites. For the European Union, what should be a cause of concern is that a prolonged period of austerity in Romania would not allow Romanian economy to catch up with the core EU economies. In order to prevent this, Romania must target economic growth as a primary target, first and foremost, from which all the others derive, including real convergence. Second, the way in which fiscal consolidation was implemented promoted inequality. Ironically, even prior to the crisis, Romania was one of the EU countries with the most pronounced inequality. as the income ratio between top 20% earners and bottom 20% earners was 7-1. The public-private wage differential, in fact, is a first problem. This is a first problem which was overstated as one of the main causes of the crisis. In fact, inequality within the system, within the public system, was even higher than inequality between the public and the private system. The fiscal system that evolved in Romania is a highly unfair system. It protects the rich and it imposes excessive taxes on the poor. For example, the marginal tax rate is the same for the billionaires and for the minimum wage worker. The Romanian fiscal and budgetary reform nowadays lacks solidarity, and that's most important. Or it misinterprets it. Everybody should pay the same cost of the crisis. Really? Did everybody enjoy the same benefits in the previous boom period? Obviously not. Solidarity should mean that the rich people should pay more, simply as this. The health reform, which was a spark of the public protests this month, took inequality above the acceptable level. In the health system, the state was supposed to continue to collect taxes just to transfer them to the private insurers, while all services, including emergency and the main package, were supposed to be delivered by the private sector. In short, who has money would live, who has not is left to die. The law was withdrawn, but it will probably return in a few months with only minor changes. Third, the legitimacy of this approach to fiscal consolidation is doubtful. The IMF program changed during its interpretation. Moreover, the austerity politics of the Romanian government took the country in an ideological race towards the bottom. Legitimacy of any reform, and after all, its sustainability, is doubtful when dialogue is missing. Let me make some closing statements. Romania and Romanian economy. Romania has a great potential, but it needs better and legitimate public policies to make use of that potential. There is a need for fiscal consolidation, and some of the austerity measures were justified. Yet, austerity in itself is self-defeating when solidarity lacks. Fiscal consolidation should address the issues of fairness, solidarity, and dialogue, or else it will end in social unrest. Social fabric must be recreated, and solidarity between social groups is a must for a successful economic recovery. Austerity and fiscal consolidation should be the result of a wide process of public debate and dialogue. Only when all layers of the society will embark upon and support these measures, they can prevail. Moreover, promoting growth should become the main priority for Romania. Measures of growth, inequality in income distribution and jobs creation should be monitored and targeted even by EU and IMF delegations. A low budget deficit is harmful when it is obtained at the cost of suboptimal utilization of resources. A state at war with itself is a state at war with its citizens. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Voina. I have someone very important in this meeting room, and I would like to give him the floor. His name is Claudiu Crăciun. He's known by many in Romania who watch television because he has been almost every day at Piața Universității, where the protests in Bucharest usually take place. Claudiu Crăciun is a university lecturer. He came to Brussels to address this audience. Aveți cuvântul, domnul Crăciun.
You have the floor, Mr. Crăciun.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me? No, that's not my place there.
Okay.
No, I'm not comfortable sitting there, so please allow me to sit here. Can you hear me? Yes. Well, let me rephrase it. Politicians, do you hear me? This is a message for Romanians, for citizens, but also for politicians. Maybe more for politicians than for citizens. And I'm here not as a leader or as a representative. There is not such a thing in the public square. Please accept me here as a storyteller. I will bring you some short stories from Piața Universității. And even though I'm here with you, my heart is with them back at home. Some of them protesting for 2 weeks in a row at minus 15. This is the place, the public square, where Romania's democratic conscience is right now. So please join me in saluting and applauding people who restored Romania's faith in democracy. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. There are difficult times when a country doesn't trust its politicians and trust its citizens. It should be trusting both. And this is the main message from Piața Universității. We want to trust politicians. We want to trust democracy. We want to trust public institutions, but don't make it so hard on us. I have witnessed a little miracle in Piața Universității. People came together from students, activists, people who were pensioners, retired people, people who worked in the corporations, having a lot of money. They all came together and they sang together. Because it's not that simple to say, we don't want the current government to go. Of course we want the current government to go. This is an immediate and necessary change. But you also need more profound change. We don't want to change just the holders of power to have the next year the same situation. So, dear politicians, from the government or from the opposition, please listen for once. For a change. Let's cherish this moment when politicians listen and citizens speak. Dear politicians from the government, dialogue doesn't mean to send combat troops beating up people, crippling them. This is not dialogue. This is not democracy. This is not something that you should defend. This is something you should be ashamed of. You and people who decided that. Opposition parties, this is not so easy. You might be happy that people are on the streets, but maybe next year they'll be there if you win elections. Please listen. Listen to them. I have witnessed a small miracle. I have said that. People from all walks of life, as we say, coming together and finding something to bind them, a solidarity, a need for change, a need for voice. Let's not stop that. Let me give you an example. People who are supporting football teams, they are the hooligans, they are the beasts. They were portrayed as such by the media. I've discovered that they are normal people, young people, having studies. I've discovered civic activists and ecological activists. After days of sitting together there, people from football fans, they were cheering for the activists. The pensioners, they were cheering for students, and the other way around. All the voices, for example, and this is a very good test case for our protest, all people, even if they didn't hear about Roșia Montană Gold Corporation criminal project based on cyanide and corruption. After days of protests, all together they sang, "We don't want it. We want cyanide, but for dictatorship, not for our democracy." And this is just the beginning. This is just the beginning, because probably Eastern Europe, New Europe, needs a spring, a democratic spring. After 20 years, people don't trust democracy. No one, or almost no one, is willing to defend it. Maybe after 20 years, we need a spring, a democratic spring, and it will come. It will come if you keep ignoring people. It will happen as in Spain, as in Israel, as in United States, maybe. People from Eastern Europe, they're looking at Bucharest. We have friends in Serbia, in Bulgaria, in Hungary, saying, we should do together something like this. We need change. So I don't want to add too many things. I'm just saying this. For 2 weeks in a row, I'm there in the public square with people I didn't knew before. I told you, pensioners, even homeless people. They come there and protest without us. I have lost my voice several times, but I have gained up hope again. Thank you very much.
Mr. Krtchun, you just invented a new way to address the European Parliament. I congratulate you for that. You probably have a bright political future. Your name means Christmas in Romania, but I see you as a prophet of the Romanian spring and maybe the European spring. Europe needs a spring indeed. I would like now to invite the politicians to come back to this podium, because we are going to hold our open debate with questions and answers. Also, in terms of announcements, Mr. Christian Preda from the European People's Party will speak during the question time, and I will ask him to perhaps to start the first after the politicians will take their seats. Is Mr. Cătălin Ivan coming? Perhaps Mr. Ponta? Yes. Yes.
Yeah. They can stay here if there are some questions related to the intervention of these two persons.
Yeah. Mr. Pervulescu and Mr. Alistar can stay until 6 o'clock, basically. And if you have questions to them, please address those questions until. As soon as you can, so that they will be able to answer you. So I give the floor now to Mr. Christian Preda.
Da, mulțumesc mult, domnule.
Thank you very much, moderator. Thank you all who made contributions so far in this debate, and I hope that we'll have a fruitful discussion on these issues. Precisely because when talking about the state of democracy, the perils facing a democracy such as the Romanian democracy, the risk of finding ourselves in a situation of crisis require a cool attitude. Such a discussion needs a reasonable approach, and I believe this is an attitude worth having precisely when we take our political adversaries very seriously. As you said, I'm a member of the EPP group. I'm a member of the European Parliament. And I would like my contribution to be taken as part of a debate concerning democracy and the risks against democracy. And because we are discussing the situation of 2012 Romania, I believe that beyond all the passion, all the hope, and all the expectation of each and every one of us, we have three clear elements that we should take into account when we discuss the situation of democracy in Romania. These three elements are the following: the relationship between the majority and the opposition. Second, the quality of the election process that is upon us. And thirdly, what will happen after the elections? I think this is the central issue, because we should discuss, because we are discussing the democracy from this electoral perspective. And since I am accustomed with the practices of the European Parliament, I shall be very brief. First of all, let me talk about the relationship between majority and the opposition. It is obvious for every political party in Romania, it is obvious that we are witnessing a sometimes dramatic breakup of the relationship between the majority and the opposition, political majority and opposition in Romania. And this breakup has gone through certain stages in the last several years. I think everyone agrees with that. And the protests that we have witnessed lately in Romania have had, as a result, the deepening of this rift, of this breakup between the opposition and the government. Strangely enough, these protests could have been a reason for the government and opposition to come closer together. Unfortunately, the opposite is the case. Now we are witnessing a deepening of the rift between the voice of the majority and the voice of the opposition. It is quite clear for me, and this has been said by the representatives of the opposition, this habit of assuming responsibility that the government has abused is a symptom of the lack of dialogue with the opposition. Beyond a constitutional procedure, a routine constitutional procedure, I think that this shows the rift and the differences between the government and the opposition. However, I'm afraid that boycotting the parliament, the measure decided by the opposition to boycott parliament, is another measure that will have similar effects, because this boycott will not lead to a healing of this rift. I believe that in order to have our point of view converge and our positions converge, well, boycotting the parliament is not the best solution for us to have a dialogue. And I'm saying this with all responsibility. So we have two choices here. Either we come closer together or we fall further apart. And I'm afraid that the decision that the opposition parties have recently taken to boycott parliament shall not contribute to bringing us closer together. And this might make our situation even worse and make the situation of democracy even worse. And I'm talking about democracy as institutions, procedures, functioning. The second element I mentioned, the trust in the electoral process. It is obvious that during an election year, with local elections and parliament in spring or summer, and later on with parliamentary elections, or who knows, maybe with snap elections, because we don't really know. We are all the choices are on the table right now. It's obvious that in such a context, we need trust. It would be dramatic if come election day Romania would be in the same situation as it is today, that is, with people radically protesting on the street, and the opposition and the majority radically contesting each other and fighting each other. Such a situation, I believe, would cause the election process to lose legitimacy and would send an extremely negative sign and signal to the citizens. Because if we were to have elections tomorrow and our discourse would be the discourse that we hear here, the election process will suffer, I believe. Trust is necessary both for those who organize elections and for those who fight the elections. Losing or winning them doesn't really matter. So if we don't have trust, we'll have a problem with the functioning of democracy. And finally, I believe that the situation of Romanian democracy is very much connected with what will happen after the elections. I've said this, and even one of the leaders of the opposition, Mr. Ponta, mentioned this. There is a risk, there is a danger that the current state of mind will prove to be to the advantage not of the democratic parties, but to the advantage of the anti-system radical parties, who will become a scourge both for the current government and for the current opposition. A repeat of the scenario that we witnessed in the year 2000 with a political force that is against democracy and wins one-fifth of the votes is a real danger, and it will affect us all, both in government and in opposition. If anybody imagines that they will be able to cynically take advantage of such a scenario, well, they're wrong. Everybody will lose, both us in the governing coalition and you, the opposition. Showing responsibility and concern for the state of our democracy would require, I believe, an intelligent alliance between the government and opposition parties in order to stop the ascension of a radical anti-democratic political force that might use the elections to gain a blackmail potential that would cause trouble to us all. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you very much. I suggest that we have, let's say, about 10 questions or comments, and then the panelists will have a chance to respond. A lot of people have asked for the floor. I think it was Mr. Enchu who was the first, then Mrs. Kingagions and Mrs. McAvey. So these will be the first three, but please be as brief as possible so we have enough time for everyone to take the floor. Mr. Enchu. Thank you, President. First of all, I would like to thank all the panelists, all the speakers, all the guests for taking part in this debate and sharing their ideas. I would like to comment on one thing and one thing only. That is that subject that has been touched upon by the vast majority of the previous speakers. That is how the governing majority in Romania has been created, because this is the source of all evils. We are talking about a parliament majority that has no popular legitimacy, because this majority was not created by the vote of the citizens, but simply by luring politicians into the governing coalition, by coercing or bribing them. And this government majority was created with the help of a significant number of politicians that were elected into the Romanian parliament on the lists of the Socialist Party, of the Liberal Party, and of the Conservative Party. And these politicians then migrated and left their parties and formed the current governing majority. So how can we talk about the fact that such a majority could be regarded as legitimate, when in fact these people are just puppets, are being maneuvered and ignore the basic function for which they were sent to Parliament, that is, to debate laws. These people accept that the government should bypass them, bypass the Parliament, and impose its will on the whole country and approve whatever laws they deem necessary. So could anybody please tell me if there is any other European Union member country with such a situation in which a national parliament, so is there any such national parliament in any European member state that has a similar situation with politicians being lured from the opposition into the governing coalition? Well, of course, when you have such a situation, people lose faith in their politicians, because people vote for a certain politician and that politician betrays them, quits his own party and joins the majority and supports completely different ideas. So from this point of view, I agree with Mr. Preda that there is very little legitimacy in the electoral process, and I believe that we are running the risk of having confidence in politicians going below zero. That is why I believe we need snap elections. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Renciu. Mrs. Macovei has the floor now.
Da, mulțumesc.
Thank you very much. I belong to the EPP group as well. There are fewer of us left in the room. 99% of us are Romanians, as far as I can see. This shows that the political opposition in Romania doesn't want to use democratic means. They boycott parliament, and for years they have said this following thing: you should vote your own laws because you are in power. They will not take part in any vote. With such an attitude, how do they justify their salaries that they get for being MPs? If our socialists, socialist and liberal colleagues from other countries were here, they might help the Romanian opposition with means to exert their influence, which is the normal thing in a democracy. Speaking of Mr. Crăciun's intervention about the University Square in Bucharest, of course, some of us present here have been there. Some parties present here went there trying to hijack the protests, and they were booed away. I haven't heard any of the three parties present here complain, take any kind of measure in order to clean up their own parties in order to answer the demands of the citizens of Romania. I would ask questions to some people who were here at the beginning but left. But I would like to ask these questions anyway, because they will hear about them, and these shed a light on their credibility. I would like to ask the presidents of the SND and the ALDE groups what their position is their official position. I will ask the heads of the two groups that organized this meeting what their official position is regarding the cooperation and verification mechanism for Romania and Bulgaria, if they have major objections to the country reports drafted by the European Commission. I have not yet heard such objections so far. If they don't have objections, because in these reports the National Anti-Corruption Department and the Agency of for Integrity are lauded for their activities, how do you reconcile your position with the position of the Romanian Social Democrat leaders, who constantly attack these Romanian institutions, which are the ones that the European Commission praises. I would also ask my colleagues from the socialist and liberal parties in Europe if they have similar situations and how they feel about the Romanian colleagues who do this and make the Romanian socialists and liberals make statements of this type, that when they get to power they would arrest all the leaders of the opposition, which clearly shows that they plan to use their political power in order to influence justice. How do our foreign MEPs feel about the threatening of judges and prosecutors? When a prosecutor starts an investigation about someone from the Social Democrat Party, he's threatened by the Social Democrat Party. I don't find this normal. Other questions for people who aren't here. I would ask Mr. Pârvulescu, who is no longer here, if it is true that he was the only leader of an NGO in Romania who said that the offer made by the Social Liberal Union to finance NGO was a good idea, but when this is actually an attempt to buy the influence of the civil society. I also had a question for the other expert who left, because I believe that European citizens need to be correctly informed and the MEPs in the European Parliament need to be correctly informed. The press says the Romanian Social Democrat Party will propose him for a Minister of Justice, but apparently he's not here to answer our questions. Mr. Alistar, do you wish to dismantle the anti-corruption institutions which were created with EU assistance and were praised by the European Commission? Is it true that you wish to dismantle the institution that checked you personally and investigated you for a conflict of interest? Is it true that you are being criminally investigated?
Oameni care nu sunt în sală și mai sunt și alții care vor să vorbească.
You're talking about people who aren't here. I will close, but you set up, says Mrs. McAvey, you set up this meeting so that any questions might only be asked at the end. But in the meantime, these people have left. I'm asking the questions now. It's your fault that these persons are not present here. I would have liked to ask questions in the beginning. When you organize a meeting, things will be different, Mr. Ivan says. Of course, I'm planning to set up such a meeting, even though I don't want to bring Romanian problems to the European Parliament. But I would like to set up a meeting about the opposition coalition and about their threats to the magistrates. I believe we will take two more questions and then we will give the floor to the politicians because we need to close at 6:30. Now,
speaker, you have the floor.
Yeah. Thank you very much. And first of all,
the
I
micro.
It is on.
No.
Yeah.
No more opportunity. Thank you very much. And first of all, I would like to say that they are not just Romanians in the room. I am a Hungarian MEP from the SND group. I am really grateful. Thank you. And I am really grateful for this hearing today. For me, it is helpful to understand it more, what is going on in Romania. And I would like to say to my colleague, Monica McAvey, who we have been working together a lot in LIBE committee, that I think that bringing Romanian problem to the European Parliament is, for me, it is quite normal, as we have done it also with Hungarian problems, let's see. And we said all the time, that since we joined the EU, problems are not just national problems. They are all European problems. We are now not the newest or youngest member states of the EU. So I think what happens in one member state, it might affect also the other member states. So I think it is quite normal that we are discussing these questions here. I am particularly grateful to the representative of the voice of those who are demonstrating in the streets. Because I think what we see in many of these countries, that people are learning more and more that democracy doesn't mean just participating in elections, voting in every 4 years. Democracy means that people have the right for transparency, they have the right for confidence in political institutions like the parliament, and the fear what we saw here. It is not showing something which might contribute to a higher level of confidence in this moment. I think people are learning more and more that they can control those who are in the power, no matter who is in the power. Democracy means that rule of law, transparency are very important. It's very important to have democracy, democratic checks and balances, trustful institutions, and so on. And I really think that democracy not just means that the majority can make decisions without dialogue, without taking into consideration of the voice of those who are in opposition. Temporarily, we know that there is a changing system. Hopefully, also with the election in Romania, it can be separated, the local elections and the national elections. And democracy is designed to solve conflicts on a peaceful way, but it is possible just in case if everyone can participate in dialogues, if everyone can contribute to these negotiated agreements. So I think critics or discussion on these problems in the European Parliament can also help to find a peaceful solution, can help it can lead to corrections which is serving the people in Romania, serving all of the citizens of the European Union altogether. So I think it is very positive that we are having this hearing, having this discussion, even if we are having different positions and opinions on these issues. I think it was more comment than questions, but thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you, Mrs. Gantz. I have one more non-Romanian speaker on my list. C'est Madame Sylvie Goulard. Guillaume.
Non, je ne suis pas Sylvie Goulard. mais nous sommes françaises toutes les deux.
We are both French. I am French and I am here because there are historical, very close links between the Romanian and French people, and I hope that these links will continue to exist in the future. I'll be very brief. I share what has just been said, the point of view then of the non-Romanians here. I would like to congratulate the gentleman who spoke earlier, who is the spokesperson for those that are in that plaza. He expressed himself very well. He was very articulate, and he was the voice of those that are there in that plaza. They want to be heard, and he is the spokesperson of all those on the streets and in the parks and plazas of Bucharest at the moment. We hope that they will continue to be able to express themselves in a peaceful fashion without having concerns for their safety. Mrs. Makovic has now gone, so I cannot address her directly, but the second thing I wanted to raise was the following. If I understood correctly her comments, she was talking about the economic crisis and how that has also affected Romania, and that is used as justification for many of the things that are happening in Romania. I think that this type of reasoning, this type of justification occurs in other countries too. It's, however, the economic crisis cannot be used as justification for what is happening in these countries. You must continue to have a dialogue with civil society, and one must continue to consult civil society. So really what I wanted to say was that I hope I understand what is happening in Romanian society at the moment. Romania has needed and will continue to need the European Union, and we feel that the European Union also needs Romania.
Sans aucun doute.
Undoubtedly. I have one further speaker on my list who is not Romanian. Enrique Guerrero has requested the floor. You have the floor, sir. Thank you very much. Unfortunately, I cannot speak Spanish because there is no interpretation from Spanish this afternoon. So I will speak French. I just wanted to express my solidarity, not with the government or the opposition in Romania, but with the people of Romania who are asking for political change in their country. They must be heard. They must be listened to. It is all political parties that must listen to what they have to say, as must the European Union as a whole. So I wanted to express solidarity with these people. In this parliament, we discussed the situation in certain countries, the situation of certain governments, and we emit a diagnosis. This is a diagnosis on the state of democracy in that country, usually. This is why many of us who are not Romanian have decided to attend this hearing, to listen to what representatives of your country have to say, and also to show solidarity with what is happening in your country. I agree with what my French and Hungarian colleagues have said, to the effect that democracy not only means that you should hold elections year after year, it also means that you must respect the views of minorities, of the opposition, and you must respect fundamental freedoms and rights and the laws in place in that country. And this is why I'm here, to express and show solidarity with those that are on the roads, in the factories, in universities, in schools, in Romania now, protesting and fighting for an improvement in their democracy, and to avoid populism and totalitarianism.
Muchas gracias, señor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Guerrero. Thank you. I think that the totalitarianism is finished now. We will now give the floor to the politicians who will reply to the comments and questions tabled. There's not much time left. We have 14 minutes precisely left. Mr. Ponta.
Vă mulțumesc.
Thank you. I will speak Romanian, so I will be perfectly understood. The first goal that this debate has been reached. The first goal was to defend those Romanians who are protesting in the streets and who were accused that they were protesting for more money, for pensions, and for economic reasons. And I think this accusation has been debunked by the young gentleman who spoke in the name of the protesters from the University Square in Bucharest. I hope that the Romanian citizens were correctly and fairly represented and defended here. I think it is the duty of all the 33 Romanian MEPs to represent and defend Romanian citizens in the European Parliament, irrespective of their political group. The second goal was to present some facts, some very clear facts. And I would like to thank Minister Sulfina Barbu, a member of the Romanian government, who confirmed what I've said from this panel. First of all, that elections are decided in Romania if it's cheaper to do them at a certain date. I disagree with that, because if we think along this line, maybe it would be cheaper if we didn't have any elections for the European Parliament as well, or for any parliament. This is not a European mentality, if cheapness is the only criterion. Second, the most important, she confirmed that the most important laws of a country, the labor law, the education law, the health system law, need to be debated with the stakeholders and need to be debated within Parliament and adopted by Parliament, and they cannot be pushed through by the government. And thirdly, that 2012 is a year during which Romania must have elections, but nobody knows when those elections will take place, how they will be organized, and how the people's representatives will be elected, be it for parliament, be it for the local authorities. So these are three facts which cannot be disputed by anybody, and it's a good thing now that our European partners know about these. And let me conclude by saying that we thought it was necessary, and this was a decision we took with our coalition partners, we thought it was necessary to take an oath in front of our political families that we shall not use the same undemocratic means after we win the elections. And let me give you just one example. We had representatives from non-governmental organizations during this hearing, invited to this hearing. I think it's important not to repeat the mistakes made by the current president, who immediately after taking power bribed a representative of the civil society by making her Minister of Justice. I think we should cease to bribe people in order to use them. I think we should learn from the mistakes of the Romanian democracy. I think we should think of Romania as a European country who must return to the values for which we all fought and from the values for which we joined the European Union. Thank you.
Domnul Crin Antonescu.
Mr. Crin Antonescu. I will not give in to the temptation or the invitation to have a debate here of the type that we usually have in Romania, because we are at home here as well. Certainly, I'm quite tempted to have a debate with Mrs. Macovei and with anyone, a debate about files, about threats, about allegations, but this is not why I'm here today. If, as my honorable colleague Christian Preda was saying, if there is some willingness for dialogue in your hearts or in your minds, then we can have this debate in Bucharest and we can all bring arguments. We came here to say things that we believe are true about Romania. We did not come here to ask for arbitrage. We did not come here to denounce each other. We did not come here to say that in Romania we have more or less than a usual protest against austerity measures. We came here to say that the opposition in Romania is, in a manner of speaking, just as representative for the Romanians as the government is today. We came to talk about the threats that we know quite well in Romania, the threats to certain rules, criteria, and values that have brought us all to the current situation and to a united Europe. I'm talking about the fact that Romania is not the only place where the government might be tempted to talk about pretexts such as the economic crisis, the need for decisive measures, the need for a government to ask forcefully. These are all true. This is a temptation that maybe is not typically Romanian. But in Romania, the government does these things without talking about them, without consultation, without talking to the opposition, to the civil society. Maybe this is not typically Romanian. And we're talking about these things. I would like to thank you once again. And I would close by saying that Romania will know how to defend its democracy and will prove that it is a healthy member of the democratic community of Europe. And as I was saying, if we won't have an intelligent alliance, then at least we might have an intelligent dialogue. From today's discussion, I come away with the following idea. No one here said that it is normal for the president to preside over the meetings of a party. This is not normal. This is something that we all agree on. And it is not normal that in Romania, for the first time in 20 years, someone changes unilaterally and without even formal consultation the rules of elections. This is not normal. Is it normal that for the first time the Ministry of Interior Affairs proposes that a prefect, a standing prefect, might be a candidate for elections at the same time, while he is in charge of assuring the election process? Let's put this aside and start a dialogue. I find that none of our numerous colleagues who are representatives of the power in Romania or of the EPP, who, even though they minimize the importance of this meeting, came here. No one answered anything to the clear statements that we made that nowadays the Romanian state is more corrupt and more expensive than ever. No one came and contested these. No one came and said, no, we're not corrupt. We do not have crony politics. No one came to say, no, our government is cheap and efficient. No one came and said this. Mrs. Sulfina Barbu, the minister, talked about reform. I have a certain age, and I remember that even before 1989, when someone spoke somewhere internationally about the breach of human rights in communist Romania, communist apparatchiks would come and read from the Romanian constitution, which stated that the human rights are protected by the Romanian law. I agree that it is necessary to have a dialogue, but from my point of view, this dialogue should not take into account our own alliances, but what a young person, a young man who has more of a claim to Romania than we do. And we should remember what he said here. And I think this can be a good conclusion of our debate today. As for the rest of it, everything else is a detail, and I'm more than willing to discuss these details. Mr. Daniel Constantin, you're young too.
Mulțumesc foarte mult.
Thank you very much. At the beginning of my statement, I referred to Liberal Democrat MEPs and I saluted their presence here. I noted that we might have a discussion in the European Parliament about the problems that can preoccupy us and other European countries, so that we might talk about certain things at the same time, you might be able to take the floor once you listen. We were hoping that you could bring solid arguments against what we said. I salute the positive attitude of Mr. Cristian Preda. This is a belated attitude. I agree with many things that he said, which I will quote. I agree that the protests in Romania have deepened the gap between the power and the opposition. I agree that the protests can give land an opportunity to an extremist party, which is regrettable. At the same time, I think we do have a solution to stop these things and sit down and have a dialogue. And I'm very glad that after a number of years, you're thinking of dialogue again. The only solution nowadays is early elections. This is a solution that initially you rejected. This means that you don't want a democratic regime in Romania. You do not want to eliminate the extremist parties. And I'd like to make a reference to an attitude which left me a bitter taste in the mouth. The attitude from some people who I thought honorable, Mrs. Tolojan, Mr. Ungureanu, Mrs. Sulfina Barbu. I think that Minister Barbu, as a representative of the government, showed and proved the most important sample of government thinking in Romania. She spoke for 10 minutes. She said things which are exactly the same as the messages that President Băsescu and Prime Minister Boc have been saying for the past couple of years, and then she left without waiting for a discussion. I will not even make reference to European funds, knowing that Mrs. Sulfina Barbu is a manager of more than 5 billion euros. Maybe it would be interesting to discuss in the European Parliament the way in which these funds are absorbed. I would close by saying that the Social Liberal Union has reached its objective today. It has brought certain issues to public debate, certain breaches of democracy. And we've also learned something from this debate. We've learned a few things from the young man from the University Square. People need to be heard. And I learned something else from the presentations from the civil society. In the year 2012, politicians need to make a commitment to the citizens, and they need to obey this commitment, unlike in previous elections campaigns, where promises were made and then consistently broken. As for the intervention of Mrs. Macovei, this only shows that Mrs. Macovei spends more time in Brussels than in Romania. She's giving the same messages we hear from President Băsescu. We're talking here about reforming political parties, but we don't mention the fact that the Liberal Democrat Party is the only party in the Romanian parliament who has a person who has been sentenced criminally and irrevocably. Thank you.
Okay, it's 6:30. I think I need to close this session. Madam Macovei, yes, if you can be short.
Da, tocmai faptul că există.
Precisely the fact that the governing party has members who were arrested and convicted of corruption shows that the justice is free, because until 2004 it was only members of the opposition that were being prosecuted. And I'm afraid this is what Mr. Ponta is promising us.
Norica Nicolae.
Domnilor, domnilor.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is a great joy for me to have spent this afternoon in the European Parliament. Unfortunately, in the history of Romania, it is only rarely that we come together for the sake of our country, and it is only rarely that we have such a dialogue. This dialogue should have happened long time ago in Bucharest. However, better late than never, and better in Brussels than nowhere else, because Brussels, after all, is our second home. Of course, for democracy to exist, confidence is necessary. It is difficult to rebuild confidence once it has been destroyed, but all of us, politicians, NGOs, civil society, we have the obligation of rebuilding this trust, because trust, confidence, is not only necessary for our individual survival, but for the survival of our nation. We all know that democracy is going through a dark period now, but the most serious thing is that undemocratic minds claim to be promoters of democracy. This has happened before in the future of Europe. We don't need that happening again. I think we all understand that. I also think that Europe, as well as Romania, need a different type of leaders. Leaders who do not have the arrogance of saying that what they say is the absolute truth, because it is only God who has the monopoly of truth. Leaders who do not have the arrogance of saying that all the things they do are good, because it is only God that has the monopoly of good. Ladies and gentlemen, if countries such as our own will be run by leaders who believe they have a monopoly on truth and who think they can only do good, then we're in big trouble. We're in big trouble because we will have to fight a temptation that I often speak about, and which was announced by Ralph Dahrendorf in his analysis of the Eastern revolutions, that is the totalitarian temptation. We failed to consolidate our institutions, we failed to develop tolerance, we failed to develop respect for dialogue, and this is why 22 years later we need to have this debate about Romanian democracy. We should understand that Romanian democracy is part of European democracy, and Europe does not only need economic solutions to the crisis. The most important solution is respect for values, respect for our democracies. If we don't have this respect, we will lose Europe. This is the context in which we must understand tonight's debate, in the context in which the Romanian case is a European case. And it's up to us, and it's up to the people next to us or in front of us, to stop class struggle, to stop this class struggle mentality and find the way forward, the way forward being democracy and the rule of law. And I will pledge that these two political groups, the liberals and socialists, will never wear t-shirts protesting against the arrest or conviction of any politician. And